for Christ, both in America and in the Philippines. When the church begins to release into the atmosphere the revelation and the understanding of God that needs to be loosed in these last days, it will disassemble and break down all the hindrances the enemy has put in place, all the blockades and everything the devil's done to try to stop it, but not be able to stop it. But whatsoever God desires will be done.
He's a prophet. He's raising up his body to remind us it's not about religion. It's not about the smoke and the lights and the fears. It's about a relationship. It's about the blood.
Christ living in the body.
Praise the Lord. God bless you on this beautiful Sunday morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. How many of you love the Lord this morning? Oh, come on, we can do better than that. How many of you love the Lord this morning? Praise the Lord. I am Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover. This is my lovely wife, Apostle Jenny Vanover. We want to welcome you to Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. Christ Living Undivided Bride. It is good to have you with us this morning. Sister Jenny, you want to say hello to everybody?
Yeah. All right, good morning, RFC. Who's excited about our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? Okay, I'm going to ask everyone to stand up. We want to give reverence and honor in the house of the Lord, and we want to be respectful unto the anointing of God. So this morning, it is our prayer that the power of the Holy Ghost will pick you up out of your problems and set your feet straight. Father, we're going to lift you up right now. In the name of Jesus, I pray, let every heart, let every mind be attentive unto your anointing. Father, we want to glorify you, and we want to worship your name. I pray, let there be a freedom in these temples today. Let there be a freedom in these vessels today. This is your house, Father, and we proclaim your name. And the whole church say, amen and amen.
Praise the Lord. Are you ready to praise the Lord today? Get your hands up. Get your hearts up. Let's praise and worship the Lord. Here's Sister Sandra and the praise team.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We're excited to be in the house of the Lord. Give him all the praise this morning, for he is worthy to be praised. Thank you, Jesus.
Take my season, not knowing where I've been. He gave me all the reasons to let it settle in, but nothing's getting in. It's suffocated with distraction. He tried to take a swing, and I'm watching every action, 'cause I know who is king. So let the heavens sing. This is a season of faithfulness. This is a season of fire in your chest. Oh, hallelujah, your spirit is breaking out. This is a season of gratefulness. It's the beginning of words flooding in. Oh, hallelujah, it's only the start of the season of the Lord. For your harvest, not knowing what's in bloom. He tried to make it darkest, where light is shining through, not knowing what you do. And I know who wrote my story, it's here above it all. This pouring of anointing that makes the giants fall, and it's breaking every wall. This is
season of faithfulness. This is a season of fire in your chest. Oh, hallelujah, your spirit is breaking
out. We thank you for the Spirit breaking out
this morning. This is a season of faithfulness. It's the beginning of what's flooding in. Oh, hallelujah, it's only the start of the season of the Lord.
Dead is alive in your presence. Your kingdom is roaring. Your season is breaking through heaven. It's starting.
It's spreading.
Dead is alive in your presence. Your kingdom is roaring. Breaking through hell void,
oh, yes,
and it's starting,
oh, yes,
and it's spreading.
Your
dead is alive in your presence, in
your kingdom.
It's roaring, your season is breaking through hell void. This is a season of faithfulness. This is a season of fire in your chest. Oh, hallelujah, your spirit is breaking out.
Let the Spirit move, Lord.
This is a season of
gratefulness. We want you to know how much we love you this
morning. Oh, hallelujah, it's only the start of the season of the Lord.
Oh, yes. We praise you. Lord, we thank you for making all things new, God. We thank you that we can walk in this sanctuary. And Father, that we just give it all to you. And Father, that as we stand here, we know that we are renewed in your spirit. Hallelujah, Jesus. We thank you, God. You're worthy to be praised. He's done all the things that he's done. He deserves all the
You take my mistakes
and make me whole.
Giants are still being slain. And God, we believe it. Yes, we can see that wonders are still what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Set our hearts on you. Come and do what you do. We need a move.
Oh yes.
We need a move. This is a move.
Oh, yes.
This is a move.
coming.
Oh, thank you, Lord, for the miracles you do.
Miracles,
oh, miracles happen. Oh, God, when he moves. Oh, yes,
coming.
You fool, in this place,
when miracles happen. When you move, healing is coming in this room. Miracles happen when you happen when you move.
Let your train
temple. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. I feel his presence here this morning. I feel the love of Jesus in this place this morning. We want to welcome all of our visitors to Revival for Christ Club. It is our prayer and our desire that you walk out with a new, enriched hope in your heart this morning. All right, so I'm going to ask everyone to take their seats, and I want to thank our praise and our worship team. Glory to God. They are awesome. Give them a hand of love. And this morning, we are going to have our Winds of Fire flag worship team present a special presentation for you.
Atmosphere is changing, nothing stays the same. Heaven is waiting for the mention of the name. The Spirit is moving, burning like a flame, healing the broken by the one we proclaim. Raise it up, fill the sky. Chains will fall, mountains move, we lift them high. Speak the name above all other names. Speak the name the wind and waves obey.
Your name is power. Your name
So many ways that we worship the Lord here in this ministry. All right, right now, Prophetess Sandra has something very special to bless you with.
The Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. How many of you know he is the way maker? Amen. He made a way for you. He made a way for me. And for that, I'm grateful to God. Hallelujah.
I worship you.
I worship you.
I worship you. the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Oh, he is your way maker.
Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are the
way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Ooh, hallelujah. He is our way maker. Hallelujah. All right, stand up to your feet this beautiful Sunday morning. Welcome to Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. And those of you who are watching us on live stream, we know that God has a blessing for you right where you are at. It is my great privilege and honor to introduce to you this wonderful man this morning. But before I do, I just want everyone to know that he is the visionary of Revival for Christ Club. At 11 years old, he was given a vision for this ministry, and now we are worldwide ministry. Also, he is the instructor for our ministers in training classes, and we have two classes going on in the week. Yes, 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 a lot of teaching, and he is also teaching the Youth Sunday School, and I know they are growing and getting a lot out of that. So my privilege and my honor to introduce you, and please stand to your feet as the man of God breaks the word of life for the next hour. Please, everyone stand up in respect and honor to the Lord, my husband, our chief apostle, Timothy Vanover.
Ooh, praise the Lord. How many of you love the Lord on this beautiful Sunday morning? Amen. While you're standing, let's go before the Lord in a word of prayer. Then you can be seated and we'll get right into the service this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, God, as we come before you, God, we come not in the arrogancy of our own ability or own knowledge, but God, we come humbly before you. Father, let this morning be a morning when your word is distributed to your people, where it's put and engraved upon the tables of their hearts. Oh, Heavenly Father, we ask the Holy Ghost to move in this place. Holy Ghost, you are the teacher. You are the comforter. Move into this place this morning. We surrender and give it all to you for your glory, God. In Jesus' name we pray. And the church said, amen. Praise the Lord. You can be seated if you want to, but sit down with a shout, amen. He's coming back with a shout. You might as well start shouting right now. Amen. Praise the Lord. Over the last couple of weeks, we've been talking on the day of the spew. Been talking about where the word of God tells us in Genesis that his spirit shall not always strive with you. He tells us in Revelations, either be hot or cold, for if you are lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. And we've been talking about a way to avoid that spew, a way to avoid getting spewed out of his mouth. For the Bible talks to us about a lukewarm attitude and a lukewarm mentality. It is time, like never before, for the rumbling of the church to begin to awaken them to the spiritual revelation and the spiritual knowledge that God is wanting to establish in the body of Christ for this last and final day. Amen. Go in your Bibles, if you would please, to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 52 is where we're going to go to. Isaiah 52. It is time for the church to have a better spiritual attitude of receptivity. It is time for us to spiritually awaken to being more sensitive and more receptive to God's word. See, one of the big problems that's happened over the years is ministers have become very confused about the responsibilities that God has given them. And let me tell you what I mean by this. God has not given you as a minister the responsibility of receptivity. He's given you the ability to deliver. Amen? Oh, y'all aren't listening to me. It is the minister's responsibility to deliver the word of God. It is the minister's responsibility to deliver it without compromise, without partiality, but in power, spirit, and in truth. But here is the thing. How you receive it is up to you. It's not up to the minister. See, for too long, we thought, well, when we prayed for someone, if they didn't get blessed enough to what we felt like, maybe we should do something. Maybe we should say it louder. Maybe we should rephrase it. Maybe we should add some more frills to it, whatever it takes to cause this person to get a reaction. No, you're missing the point. What God has placed in you is his word. What God's placed in you is his spirit and his anointing. Your only responsibility as a minister is to deliver as clearly and as precisely as you can without any way of determining or accepting or deciding the receptivity of the person that's receiving it. See, for too long, we as ministers have taken responsibility for how someone receives it. How you receive it is totally up to you. My only job is delivery. I will deliver it precisely, without hypocrisy, without partiality, in power, spirit, and truth. I will not speak my words. I will speak his words. But how you receive it is up to you. If a person gets blessed, it's because they received it as a blessing. If a person does not get blessed, it's because they rejected it as not being of God. But that's a choice that person has to make. You as a minister, that is not your responsibility. Your responsibility of how people receive what you minister, when you lay hands on them, how they react to the way you lay hands on them, is not up to you. It is up to the spirit and the anointing of God and the willingness and the humbleness of the individual receiving that blessing, receiving that touch. Amen? That's why I've always been one of those. I never worry. I just go, hey, I'm going to deliver. I'm going to pray. Boom, move on down the road. Deliver, pray, move on down the road. I don't worry about if somebody thinks that's the greatest prayer they ever got. I don't worry if somebody feels like that's the greatest spiritual touch they've ever received, because I tell you something, I'm not here to promote Timothy Vanover. I'm not here to lift up Timothy Vanover. This is not Timothy Vanover ministry. This is Revival for Christ Club. My job is to stimulate your hunger and your desire for the revelation and the knowledge of God, to deliver that revelation without hypocrisy, to deliver that revelation straight, true, powerful, and anointed. And how you receive it is up to you. And what you do with it is up to you. I'm not responsible for it once it leaves this pulpit. And that's one of the biggest mistakes I see ministers make. They try to be responsible for what they've preached after they've delivered it. And then comes in the deal where you find yourself trying to control people's lives, trying to insert yourself places you don't need to be. Let me tell you something. I'm not here to worry about what anyone else's life is going on in your life. I don't want to be in control of your life. I want you to have a relationship with Jesus Christ so that you know what should be happening in your life, what should be happening in your family. Now, when you come, I will preach the word of God. I will preach truth. If you find me on the road somewhere and you ask me, I will tell you what the truth is. I will never turn from it, but I will not also not work to manipulate its receptivity. Come on, how many understand what I'm saying? I'm not trying to set a condition for you to accept or get a hold of this thing. Either you hunger and you thirst for God, or you do not. Either you want to get closer to him or you do not. And there is absolutely nothing that I'm going to do or going to say that is going to make you want to get closer to God if you've already determined in your heart you don't want to. If you've already determined in your heart that you let God into this part of your life, but you won't let God into all of your life. You'll let God do this, but you won't let God say that. You'll let God say that, but God can't say this. Honey, you got to come to a place of surrender. You've got to come to a place where you lift up your hands and say, God, not my will, but your will. God, not what I want, but what you want. God, not what I desire, but what you desire. Amen. Go in your Bibles. Isaiah chapter 52. Now, I read this scripture last Sunday, but I'm going to read it again. Amen? because I just kind of ran over it last Sunday. Isaiah chapter 52. This message could be so spoken today around the world, and it would fit. Isaiah 52 and 1. Awake, awake. Put on thy strength, O Zion. Put on thy beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. For henceforth there shall no more come unto thee the uncircumcised and the unclean. Now I want you to look what he's trying to say. He's saying, awake. And he doesn't just say it once, he says it twice. That's an emphasis. He says, awake, awake. He said, you need to wake up out of the slumber of your flesh. You need to wake up out of the slumber of your confusion. You need to wake up out of the slumber of your lack of spiritual revelation and spiritual understanding. You need to awake and acknowledge the condition of your state. Have you awoke to acknowledge the condition of your state? Can you examine your state and say, I am in the place that I need to be with God? That if God were to call me home today, I could look at God and say, I've done all that you commanded. I tried to be obedient to you in every area. I did what you said, God. Or would you be someone that says, Lord, give me just a little bit more time. God, give me another week. Give me another month. Give me another year. Give me a couple of years. God, I'm not where I need to be, but I'm going to get there. God, if you'll give me a little more time, I'll get there. Honey, God's given us 2,000 years to wake up. God's given us 2,000 years to become the body of Christ. God's given us 2,000 years to be the bride of Christ. I believe it's time for the bride to arise. I believe it's time for the bride of Christ to stand up. I think it's time that we stop making excuses for changes, that we stop making excuses when God wants to bring a change in your life. Amen? Now, like what he says, awake, awake. Put on thy strength, O Zion. Just put on your beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. What's he talking about? Put on thy strength. What did he tell the disciples? Strength is an association with power. Would that be correct? You preach at me. You tell me. Is power and strength pretty much the same thing? Yeah, they are. Power and strength are very similar. To have strength means you have power. To have power means you are strong. To be strong means you have strength. Can you say amen? And I believe, if I am not mistaken, that Jesus told those disciples something about strength. He told them, don't go out and talk about me. Don't go out and preach about me until you meet a condition. Till you meet something, till you have strength and power to do it effectively and to do it with clarity. He said, tarry ye in Jerusalem till you be endued with power from on high. Oh, you're not listening to me, church. It is time for the church to awake. It is time for the church to stop shoving the Holy Ghost out the front door. It's time to get the Holy Ghost back in the house of God. It's time to put on the Holy Ghost. Come on, y'all ain't listening to me. Put on the Holy Ghost, your strength. Oh, come on, y'all ain't listening to me. Honey, do you know why the devil wants you in slumber? Do you know why the devil wants you running around like a chicken with your head cut off in your flesh? You know why he wants you to do that? Because if you do that, there's no strength. If you do that, there's no power. And if you ain't got no strength, you can't take him. If you ain't got no strength, you can't defeat him. But I'm telling you, church, awake. Church, wake up. We have got to stop with all this entertainment. And we've got to get into the Word and the Spirit of God. We've got to bring the Holy Ghost back in the house of God. And we've got to get humble to the Spirit of God. He says, awake, awake. He's talking to us. He's talking to his church. Awake, awake. Put on strength. Where does strength come from? Strength comes from power. Where do we get our power? From the Holy Ghost. Didn't I believe, if I'm not mistaken? Didn't Jesus tell him? You shall receive power when? I'm sorry, you shall receive power when? I believe it's Acts 1, right? You shall receive power when? After. When should you get strong? After. When shall you have strength? After. When shall you have ability, Brother Daryl? After. See, that's something we need. We need, there are some of you, God bless you, I love you to death. But you ain't spoken tongues so long, you don't even know what tongues is. Honey, you got filled with the Holy Ghost 20 years ago, and that was good enough, and you ain't done nothing else with it. Let me tell you something. When you got filled with the stream, it was supposed to turn into a river. When you got filled with a brook, it was supposed to, oh, come on, you were supposed to turn into an ocean. When the fountain started flowing out of your belly, it was supposed to flow for all eternity. That's what it was supposed to. The Holy Ghost gives you strength. You tell me one element. I want you to go ahead. You can preach back at me. Tell me one element. One element that has more power, more anointing, and more authority than the Holy Ghost. And you'll say Jesus Christ, and you're right. But Jesus Christ is not in conflict with the Holy Ghost. Can you say praise God? They work in total unity together. See, the thing we forget is that it's the Word. Jesus Christ made flesh and dwelt among us. It's the Word and the Spirit. Oh, y'all ain't hearing me. It's the Word and the Spirit. They have to work together. And who was the Word? Jesus Christ was the Word of God made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld him as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace. Is that correct? Amen. So when he says, put on your strength, he's saying, put on the Holy Ghost. And when you put on the Holy Ghost, Daryl, it's going to bring illumination. It's going to bring understanding. It's going to take the words that are on a page and begin to breathe a wind of life upon them. And those words on a page are going to breathe. And the Word of God is going to become the living Word of God. And as you establish and put that living Word of God into your spirit and into your heart, you shall become a living flame for the kingdom of God. Say, brother, where do you get that from? Our God is consuming fire. And he makes his ministers flames of fire. That's where I get it from. Makes his ministers flames of fire. Now, you put on the strength. You put on the Holy Ghost. With the Holy Ghost comes illumination. With illumination comes interpretation. With interpretation comes revelation. From revelation comes transformation. From transformation comes manifestation. Can you say praise God? You never get from the origin point to the point of manifestation without the Holy Ghost. You can't make it there. You can never make it there. People say that I've got Jesus in my heart and I want to live and I want to show Jesus. Well, how can you live and show Jesus without the Holy Ghost? How can you be what God called you to be without being subject to the Holy Ghost? I want you to stop and think about this for just a minute, my friend. Jesus told his very own disciples, tarry ye, don't leave, don't go, don't preach until you be endued with power from on high. Because he said, unless you got the strength, oh, help me, Lord. Unless you got the strength, you'll never discover the beauty. Oh, y'all ain't hearing me. Unless you got the strength, you'll never discover the beauty. Put on my garments of strength. And then what's the next garment? What's the next thing on there? You put on the strength, then what do you put on? He said, put on. He said, put on thy strength, O Zion. Put on thy beautiful garments, O Jerusalem, the holy city. Now, when he's talking about Jerusalem, he's not talking about the land over there. He's talking about a spiritual Jerusalem. You say, Brother Vanover, how can you say that? Because our God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And you have to understand these have spiritual connotations to them. These spiritual knowledge and wisdom is what unlocks the relationship and revelation for you to be what God intended for you to be. Now he says, awake, That means get out of slumber of your flesh. Awake. Come out of that place where you are not conscious. You are not alert. You are not aware to what's happening around you. Put on your garments of strength. First you put on the Holy Ghost. And then what happens? As you put on the Holy Ghost, it brings illumination. It brings understanding. And as you begin to look at the Word of God, it's no longer just words on a page, but it's living, breathing, transforming revelation. And as you begin to see the Word for what it was truly meant to be, as you begin to see the Word in the relationship building process it was meant to build, two words preach today: W-O-R-D and W-O-R-D. They look the same and they sound the same, but it's when you break down their substance that you receive the truth of them. W-O-R-D, this is the word the world is preaching, the wisdom of religious doctrine. Religious doctrine does not transform. Religious doctrine does not change. Religious doctrine is a facade to try to fool you into believing something spiritual when it is not. The other word, W-O-R-D, is the wisdom of righteous doctrine. And the difference between righteousness and religion is religion does not require relationship. Oh, you're not listening to me. Religion does not require relationship, Bishop. But see, I'm going to tell you something. Let me tell you something this morning. You listen to me, church. Religion doesn't require relationship, but righteousness demands it. Oh, you're not hearing me. Righteousness demands it. To be in right standing with someone, you have to be in relationship with that person. You have to know them more than just on a casual relationship. You have to know them intimately. You have to know them deeply to be in right standing. So when he says, awake, awake, put on my strength, O Zion, it happens. As I put on the Holy Ghost, it brings illumination. It brings understanding. It brings interpretation. It releases revelation. And it's in the release of that revelation. Oh, come on. It's in the release of that revelation that I'm standing in righteousness. Right standing with God. And it's in that point. It's in that state. It's in that condition of righteousness I discover His real beauty. Oh, y'all ain't listening to me. That's when I discover His real beauty. That's when, Daryl, I get transformed from a lost person. That's when I get transformed, Daryl, from a Gentile into a holy city. Honey, we are supposed to be a city upon a hill that cannot be hid. We're supposed to have the light of Jesus Christ permeating every part of our speech, of our actions, and of our life. But see, it's when we put on that strength. When the Holy Ghost takes hold, it brings illumination. It brings a light of wisdom to the Word. And then it brings interpretation. And it's from the light and the interpretation. Light spelled L-I-G-H-T. Living in God's holy truth. If you're living in His truth, there is a light that shines out of you. If you are not living in His truth, it is darkness. Amen? But He said, awake, awake. Come out of that non-conscious state. Come out of that dream state and enter reality. Amen? And then what He says, put on thy strength, O Zion, that's the Holy Ghost. And then after you do that, illumination, revelation, interpretation comes. Transformation begins to take place. And then you're able to put on the beautiful garments. O Jerusalem, the holy city. And look what it says. For henceforth, there shall no more come unto thee the uncircumcised and the unclean. Uncircumcised represents sin, or represents flesh, and unclean represents sin. Can you say praise God? He said, if you will apply the Spirit and you will apply the Word and the Spirit, if you will take on the garments of transformation, if you will take on the Holy Ghost and you will take on the Word of God, there will be a transformation. The image and the nature of Jesus Christ will begin to come alive in you. And as that image and nature comes alive in you, your flesh will be crucified. Your sin will be removed and you will walk in the forgiveness and the spiritual inheritance of our Heavenly Father. Let me show you what I'm talking about. here comes the problems. When you just put on a garment of strength, this is what you look like. I got my garment of strength. I'm looking sharp today. I'm looking well-dressed today. I got my garment of strength. But the Bible said I need a garment of beauty. So when I put my arm in this garment of strength, it leads me to put my arm in the garment of beauty. Amen. Come on. Now, you understand what I'm saying? See, if you take the Spirit and you take the Word and you put them together. Oh, y'all ain't listening to me. One mind, one spirit, one accord. I cover my flesh in the image and nature of Christ. How many understand what I'm saying? That's why he's telling us, get us ready for the day. Y'all ain't listening. He's getting you ready for the day. You can't get up and get ready for the day till you get your garment on. You can't get ready for a day of revelation. You can't get ready for a day of understanding. You can't get ready for illumination till you get yourself ready, till you get your garments on. Amen. Did you come in here with spirit and no word? Did you come in here with word and no spirit? The point is, if we're going to have the image and the nature and the personality that God wants us to have, it's going to require the Word and the Spirit. It's going to require the wisdom of righteous doctrine. How do we get in right standing with God? How do we find that right standing place with God? You cannot find a right standing place with God if the only time you associate with Him is on Sunday and Wednesday. And for some people, Easter and Christmas. If that's it, then you're not going to be in right standing with God. And if you're not in right standing with God, you're in error. See, we're moving into a time the church has never been. We're moving into a place the church has never been before. You know, if Jesus and his disciples thought that was the last days, what do you think this is telling us? We are moving way closer to that time and that moment where God's going to say, I will not always strive with man. I won't always put up with the nonsense. Amen? The last thing the church needs to do is emulate that nonsense. The last thing the church needs to do is look to the world for guidance. To look for the world for a compass of morality. To look for the world for the compass of what is right. If you want to know what the compass to morality is, it's right before you. It's called the Word of God. If you want to know what the compass of fairness and equality is, it's the Word of God. If you want to know an answer to every problem and situation you are experiencing, it's the Word of God. You may not like the answer, but it's still the answer. How many of you understand what I'm saying? Let's go on. I got to hurry. He said, no more shall the uncircumcised, that is your flesh, or the unclean sin, enter in when you're covered in the right garment, when you have the right garment on. Shake thyself from the dust. Does anybody know what dust is associated with in the Word of God? Flesh. Right? He's always telling the disciples, shake the dust from your feet and move on. Shake the flesh and move on. See, flesh ain't nothing more than a bunch of dust. Just wait to deteriorate. Amen? So come on, let's look what it says. He says, shake thyself from the dust. And I love this part. Arise and sit down, O Jerusalem. Loose thyself from the bonds of thy neck, O captive daughter of Zion. For thus saith the Lord, you have sold yourselves for naught, and you shall be redeemed without money. Now, I want you to look what he says. I think this is so cool. He tells you, and I'm going to show you, I showed this Sunday, but I'm going to do it again because I think it's good. Crandall will help me with it. John, stand up. John, sit down. John, stand up. Stand up, John. Sit down, John. You can see that would look contrary, right? And the Bible, of course, tells us a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways, right? So we know that God is not double-minded, and we know God doesn't have a double standard. So why does he look and say, arise and sit down? What is it saying? Spiritual man, arise. Flesh, set down. Oh, come on, church. We'd be getting a lot more places if we let the Holy Ghost rise in us and set our flesh down. If we let the Holy Ghost come alive in us and bring our flesh under subjection, we'd be in a lot better situation, in a lot better place. Amen? Go with me, if you would, please, to Romans chapter 13. Romans, the 13th chapter. So you say, Brother Vanover, what are you trying to say this morning? I'm trying to say, if you want to stay away from a lukewarm mentality, you need the right garments. And in order to get the right garments, you've got to set your flesh down and raise up your spirit, man. As you raise up your spirit, man, you put on the garment of strength, put on the garment of beauty, you put on the word and the spirit, and now you reflect the true nature and image of Jesus Christ. See, there is the problem. If you're trying to produce the image of Jesus Christ without the spirit, you're missing 50% of the puzzle. And you're only going to get 50% of the understanding. Only when you submit to the anointing, only when you submit to the Holy Ghost, only when you follow the same requirement Jesus Christ himself made of all of his disciples, when he told them, tarry ye in Jerusalem until you receive the promise of my Father, until you are baptized with the Holy Ghost. John said, I indeed baptize you with water, but there's one coming after me, whose shoe latches I am not worthy to unloose, and he shall baptize you in the Holy Ghost and in fire. If you remember what Paul said to the disciples of Apollos in Acts 19, you remember what he said to them? This is where a lot of people get confused, because they think, well, when you get saved, you get the Holy Ghost. And apparently Paul is incorrect. Because when Paul meets disciples, he doesn't say they're not believers, they're believers. They believe in Jesus. But when he meets them, he says to them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? So I ask him a question. They're not believers. But I think after sitting there and talking to him for a little bit, Paul got to saying, hey, wait a minute. Bishop, these guys aren't very spiritual. Hey, wait a minute. They're not speaking about very many spiritual issues. I'm concerned about their relational status with God. So he looked at him and said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Now, he put it in there as a condition of since you believed. And then, as we all know, there are two baptisms. Baptism of John the Baptist and the baptism of Christ, Jesus Christ. Amen. Then Paul asks him, I love this question. Yes. So then what baptism were you baptized with? He said, you don't got the Holy Ghost. So what baptism were you baptized with? And they said, oh, we got the baptism of John. And he said, that's a baptism unto repentance. But bless God, Josephine, when you've got Jesus Christ in your life, you are covered by the blood. You've got repentance. What you need is the fire. What you need is the Holy Ghost. That is what you need. And that's what they needed. And the Bible says Paul laid their hands on them, prayed over them, and said they were filled with the Holy Ghost. How do we know they were filled with the Holy Ghost? For they heard them speak in tongues and magnify God. Amen? I don't know why it's so hard for people to embrace speaking in tongues. They have no problem embracing catching pneumonia to get wet, but they have a problem with speaking in tongues. I mean, most of the world will accept the fact that you need to be dunked and you need to get in some water and go. But why is it you have no problem with getting wet, but you have a problem with letting that heavenly language speak through you? Amen? Praise God. Well, I don't want anybody thinking I'm strange. I don't want to run anybody off. I don't want to make anybody mad. Honey, I'm telling you something. That is the worst lie that ever moved into the church house. That is the worst lie that anybody ever accepted. Honey, if you get offended, God bless you and roll on down the road. I am not here to please you. I am not here to make you happy. I am not here to so you can say, oh, that's a good preacher. I'm here to deliver the word of God without hypocrisy, in power, in spirit, and in truth. Nothing I've spoken to you today, nothing I've said to you today is not Bible. And I'm not concerned. If you know me long enough, you know well enough, I am not concerned at offending people. If you like your flesh, I will offend you. If you are in your flesh, I will be the worst nightmare you have ever known. Because I will press, beat, tear that flesh up until nothing is left but oil. Beautiful oil. I don't know if you know what they do to the olive, but they shake it. Oh, y'all ain't listening to me. I don't know if you know what they do with the virgin olive, but they shake it. Then they beat it. Oh, come on. Somebody ain't listening to me. Then they press it. Woo, y'all ain't listening. See, this is what the church needs. We need a shaking. We need to shake that dust off of us. We need to beat the flesh under control to the spirit, and we need to allow God to press our flesh out so our anointing can flow. Woo, come on. I'll give you a crazy prayer. I'll give you a crazy prayer to pray this week. Say, God, shake me. God, beat me. God, press me. God, press me. And I want you to see, 7 days from now, you'll have some oil showing up. Oh, come on, church. You'll have that virgin oil. You'll have that oil that is not contaminated by your stinking thinking. You'll have that oil that is not contaminated by what man thinks, what the world thinks, what anybody else thinks. You will be locked on, and your eyes will be set upward from which cometh your salvation. Can you say amen? Well, praise the Lord. It's good in here. You go with me to Romans real quick. You getting blessed over there, bro? Praise God. Want some of that pressing? Some of that pressing? Amen. Romans 13. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God is good. Romans 13, verse 11. And that knowing the time is now high time to awake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. Now listen, church. Let's talk about it right now. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness. And let us put on the armor of what? Light, living in God's holy truth. Let us walk honestly as in day. Not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chamberling and wantonness, not in strife and envying. Put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lusts thereof. I want you to look what he said. He said, the night is far spent. He said, for too long, we've had a lack of spiritual insight. For too long, my churches have lacked revelation. For too long, my churches have ministered and preached a milked-down, watered-down version of my word. But I am telling you, warriors are rising. They're rising with shields, and they're rising with swords, and they're going to cut asunder of soul and moral. They're going to remove every element of distraction, every element of hindrance. They're not going to be afraid to speak the word of God, even if it cost them their life. Because speaking the truth will become more important than breathing. Come on, become more important. Look what he said. He said, the night is far spent. That moment of spiritual under, night represents darkness, represents the inability to see, represents a lack of light or very small or little to no illumination. That's what night means. He said, the night is far spent. For too long, the church has walked in darkness. For too long, the church has walked without illumination. For too long, the church has walked without the light of God's anointing and God's spirit. He said, but that day must change. Even as he said in Isaiah, awake, awake, put on the spirit, put on the word, put these on, and something's going to happen. A transformation is going to take place. He said, the day is at hand. He said, the day's at hand. Hand is spelled H-A-N-D. H-A-N-D. Holy, anointed, new direction. Oh, come on, hear me, church. When illumination, understanding, revelation is going to come when you receive holy, anointed, new direction. And how are you going to receive holy, anointed, new direction? Through the hand of God. You know, I love what people say. How many hands God got? Got two. I know God's got two because you got two. He made you in the likeness of his own image. One hand is for you, the individual. One hand is to hold the church. I'll do the church first because that's in Ephesians. Five fingers on each hand. Apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, and evangelists. Apostles for vision. Prophets for guidance. Evangelists for proclamation. Pastors, they are married to the church for establishment. And teachers to clean the wax out of your ears so you can hear what God's saying. Amen. Praise God. But then the other hand is for you, the individual. This is the day of spiritual understanding comes from this hand. Comes from this holy, anointed new direction. It has five fingers. These are five elements that every true believer must possess. These are five elements that every minister must possess. You know, we talk about so many things we think ministers should possess that are worthless and mean nothing. These are five elements that you must have. These are five elements that must be prominent in you. Where do we get these five? From the best blueprint of all time, Jesus Christ. What are those five elements? The Word, the Spirit, the power, the authority, and the anointing. Come on, Jesus was the Word of God made flesh and dwelt among us. He was anointed of the Holy Ghost to go forward and speak all that he spoke. He had power to cast out devils. He had power to raise people from the dead. Everybody that ever heard him said he spoke with greater authority than the scribes and Pharisees. He had authority like nobody else's business. And his very name, Christ, means what? Means what? Anointed one, anointing. Those five elements were in Jesus, Word, Spirit, power, authority, and anointing. And those five elements have to be in you. Those five elements of Word, Spirit, power, authority, and anointing will come together as you begin to assemble together the Spirit and the Word. As you begin to put on the garment of strength and the garment of beauty, guess what's going to happen? The image and nature of Jesus Christ is going to begin to come alive in you. The words that you speak will not be your words, but they will be his breath and his speech speaking through you. Moving through you. Here lies the problem in the church today. We are so concerned with who might be offended if they walk through the door. We don't get concerned about how we might offend the one whose house it is. Are you listening to me? Mama don't want you walking through her living room with muddy shoes on. Then you take your shoes off at the door. You take the shoes off at the door. I tell you, my mama never got upset when my friends came over with dirty feet for them to say, you leave those shoes outside. Don't you track that stuff through my house. Don't you track that in there? But see, we're so worried. We don't want to say anything to anybody. Let me tell you something. I am not going to play patty cakes. I am not going to play footsies with you. I'm going to speak the word of God. I don't care if you get offended. I don't care if you get upset. I don't care if you get mad. Get mad and get glad again in the same pants you got mad in. Honey, it is time to make up your mind. Are you a believer or not? Are you going to follow God or not? Are you going to play church? Or are you ready to become the church? I don't know about you, but I'm ready to be the church. I'm ready to become the church. Amen? Goes on and says, the night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us cast off the works of darkness. Let us put on the armor of light. Start living in God's holy truth. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting or drunkenness or in chamberling or wantonness, not in strife or envy. But put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ and make not provision for the flesh to fill the lust thereof. You know what that means? Stop justifying. Stop saying this is okay because of this, and that's okay because of that, and this is okay because of that. You should not have to justify what is already justified in you. You're not listening to me. What God justifies requires no further justification. it requires no further justifying. If God calls it just, if God calls it equitable, if God calls it right, then it is right, and no man can change it. But let me say something to you, church. It is time, as never before. Before, maybe you had 5%, 10%, maybe 15%, maybe 20% that actually had the armor of Christ shining on them. But we are moving into a day and an hour when we need more than 20%. We're moving into a day and an hour when we need more than 30% or 40% or 50% or 60%. We used to sing a song when I was in the choir as a kid, 99.5% will not do. And that is 1,000% right. God is raising up an army. God is raising up men and women that are not going to be worried about offense. God is raising up men and women that have put on the garment of strength, who have put on the garment of beauty, and that image and nature of Christ is shining through them. And they're going to let that light shine. And if it offends you, you'll get offended. But nobody's making you be a part of it. Nobody's telling you you have to do it. It's just like this. If you don't like what we're saying, if you don't like the anointing, the spirit you're feeling, you just turn it off. It's not a problem. Just turn it off. But one thing it's not doing is it's not changing to appease you. It's not changing to make you happy. See, I have one responsibility and one obligation. That is to preach that word as clearly and as precisely as I possibly can. To piece together and assemble together in it the spiritual knowledge and revelation necessary to establish you in an active, intimate relationship with your heavenly Father. Amen? Let's hurry. I'm almost finished. One more passage and I'll let you go. Go to 1 Corinthians. Some of y'all looking at me like you need to eat lunch. 1 Corinthians 15. I don't have any sandwiches up here. So. All I got's a little steak. And you need a Holy Ghost sword to cut into it. Okay, go with me. 1 Corinthians. And I'm in the 15th chapter. 1 Corinthians 15 chapter. I'll be reading out of the Amplified on this one. I like the way the Amplified says it. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 34. All right, I'll tell you what, let's go up to 33. Do not be so deceived and misled. Evil companionships, communication, and associations corrupt and deprave good manners and morals and what? Character. How many times you guys heard Brother Venover say, watch your associations? How many heard Brother Venover say, be careful of your associations? If your association don't share the same love you have, they will distract you to a different love. They will try to get you distracted to the love they have. Honey, you need to be with people who share your love, people who share what you love. Amen? Look what he says here. Do not be deceived and misled. Evil companionships, communion, and association. Corrupt and depraved good manners and morals and character. When you hang out with bad associations, when you allow yourself to feed on things that do not glorify God, when you allow yourself to feed on things that do not turn your attention, your affection, and your passion towards God, those are dangerous associations. Those are associations you need to be careful of. He goes on and says, and one more time I'm going to say it to you, awake. Oh, come on, people. He's saying it. He's saying, awake. Awake from your drunken stupor and return to sober sense and your right minds and sin what? Make justification for sin? Make excuses for sin? Continue to sin? What's it say? Sin no more. For some of you, have not the knowledge of God. You are utterly and willfully and disgracefully ignorant and continue to be so, lacking the sense of God's presence and all true knowledge of Him. I say this to your shame. Now what Paul's trying to say to him is the same thing he's trying to be saying Isaiah. Awake. Come on, guys, wake up. Come on, your associations are good. Wake up. Put on the garment of strength. Put on the garment of beauty. Let your flesh be brought under subjection. Let your sin be eliminated. And let the image and nature of Christ begin to radiate in you and everything you do. Amen? You need to understand one thing. If you don't understand anything else, please understand this. you are not your own. You do not belong to you. You were bought with a price. You were paid for with precious, holy blood. So it's not for you to dictate the conditions of service or the conditions of church to God. It is for you to receive the instructions from him. It is for you to wheel yourself to him. We may never be the biggest church on the block, but we will be a church of true believers. We will be a church that knows how to put on its garments. We will be a church that knows how to live in the light. We will be a church that knows how to receive revelation. We will be a church that understands how to apply the revelation we receive. We will be a church that works for established truth. We will be a church that lets the Holy Ghost and the Spirit of God be our guide. For as many as led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. And how can you be led by something you do not accept? How can you be led by something you deny even exists? Awake is spelled A-W-A-K-E. A-W-A-K-E, awake. And it stands for anointed wisdom, activating kingdom excellency. When you wake up, you get some anointed wisdom, and you start activating that kingdom excellency. You go back to what Paul said. He said, I was circumcised the eighth day of the tribe of Benjamin. As touching the law, I was a Pharisee. I was raised at the feet of Gamaliel, the greatest teacher in all of Jerusalem. Yet I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus. This is what the church needs. More excellence. Less compromise. Less cowardice and more, much more, much, 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 much more commitment, dedication, letting Christ be reflected in all of your actions. Can you say praise the Lord? How many of you love the Lord this morning? He's worthy to be praised. Amen. I tell you this morning, church, awake, awake. Put on your garments of strength. Put on your garments of beauty. Let the image and nature of Jesus Christ begin to come alive in you. It's not your flesh that dictates the conditions of service. It's the Spirit that lives in you that dictates the conditions of service. God bless you. Thank you for coming this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I ask you to bless your people this morning. You just want to be obedient. Everybody lift up your hands for just a minute. We're going to obey the Lord for just a second. Just want to be obedient to God. For just a minute. Brother Kenny, could you come here for a second? Right here. I mean, I don't know why. I just saw this. I'm just going to pray for you. Doesn't make any sense to me. Maybe it makes some sense to you. I don't know. Just come on up here. I just saw him pray for you anyway. Whatever the case, God bless you. I just felt like that. I felt like from the Lord to pray for your body. I know, but the Lord said there's a special healing that's going to take place in your body. He said, get ready. Just lift up your hands. Right now, Father God, I don't know why you spoke this to me. Lord, I don't understand, I don't know. But you said pray for him and pray for his body. And that's what I'm going to do. Healing. Healing. In the name of Jesus. 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 Praise God. Michael, would you step right up to the edge of the altar there? Just Brother Michael. So lift up your hands, Brother Michael. Just begin to praise the Lord. God said, son, I've been bringing you up a mountain. And he said, right now you're standing on a plateau, and there's much to see and much to understand and much to comprehend, and I will reveal it all to you. But son, know that I am proud of your climb, for you have kept your eyes upward from which cometh your salvation. You've not looked down, but you've looked up. And he said, son, get ready, because I will take you to the mountaintop. I will take you to the mountaintop. Keep your eyes upward from which cometh your salvation. Touch him, God. In Jesus' name. Take him to the mountaintop. Take him to the mountaintop. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For those of you that are watching on our live stream, thanks for tuning in. God bless you. Don't forget Sundays 11, Wednesday 7:30, Monday 10, and Thursday 10 on the CFAN, Christ Family Apostolic Network. Thank you for tuning in. God bless. Praise the Lord.
Hello, my name is Ryan Colley. I'm International Evangelist and Administrative Vice President of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to help us take revival around the world to our over 17 churches in the Philippines, to our friends in Honduras, Mexico, Singapore, and Malaysia, this is how you can do it. First off, you can send your checks or money orders to 1005 Southwest 4th Street in Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. You can also call in with credit card at 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can do it through the Cash App. That's money sign RFC ROAR. That's money sign RFC ROAR. Thanks in advance for helping us take the flame around the world. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision, built on a plan, the Word of God.
Listen to the end.